Well, as you know, we've been talking about what we believe, and I prepared a message, which, you know, as I always try and do, but I'm always open to what the Lord may want to do in the service. And so this morning, I'm going to do something a little bit different, and I want to talk to you for just a few minutes about why we believe in the one true God. Why we believe in the one true God. And if you have a Bible this morning, I want you to just look at a couple scriptures with me. How many of you, I don't know how many of you know this, Exodus chapter 3, if you want to turn there. Exodus chapter 3. In America, you don't drive down the street necessarily and see a lot of idols. Amen? At least what we would think of when we think of idols, correct?
Right.
I mean, there's a couple of Buddhist temples, I think, out by Lakeville or Farmington or somewhere, and they actually do have like statues outside that you can see as like you drive by, and it's really weird. Like when you drive by, Candy, you're like, you know, minding your own business, cow, farm, barn, Buddha. Wait a minute, what? I mean, so but generally speaking, you don't really see that very much. Now, my question for you is this. Does that mean that there's not idolatry in America?
No,
of course not. It means that it takes a different form than maybe we would think of in the Bible times. And so one of the realities is that what I shared last week, which I just want to remind you about in case you aren't here or you're watching online and weren't able to tune in, is that we're living in a time where the church in America is more focused, or moving, it seems, to focus on sociology rather than theology. Sociology is the study of and development structure of the human society, whereas theology is the study of God and God's relation to the world. So why is that important? Well, what we established last week when we talked about the Bible is, if we're unsure if this is the literal word of God, then our faith is in vain. Right? Because if we're unsure whether we can believe that God created the world, if we're unsure whether Jesus really rose from the dead, and how many of you know what that video is based on? The Apostles' Creed, right? On the third day, he rose again. I know we haven't even done Christmas the other day, but the other day I got really excited about Easter. And maybe it's because I like to just skip winter this year. I don't know. But how many of you know, if we're unsure if the Bible is true, if we're unsure if Jesus rose from the dead, if we're unsure if God created the universe, then as Jody says, we're unsure about everything. And what happens then is our faith is on shaky ground, which means that, and this is important, I want you to grasp this. If we're unsure about whether or not God is who he says he is, then that means we walk out of this place this morning unsure if his power is with us.
Right.
And that's a problem.
Right.
If we're not sure God is who he says he is, if we're not sure that the power of God is available, then guess what? We leave here on shaky ground. Look at Exodus chapter 3. Today we're going to talk about Christian theism. Everybody say Christian theism.
Christian theism.
It comes from the Greek word theos, and it means God. And it holds that the one true God is present in his universe, and that his ear is open to the cry of his children. Last week we talked a little bit about some of the different beliefs that some people believe. Oh, I believe there's a God, you know, he's out there, but he doesn't really care about me or the universe or what's happening to me. How many know that's sad,
yeah,
right? There's
sad.
A lot of people who believe that.
Sad.
I like what Karl Barth, I introduced you guys to Rabbi Zacharias last week, and Jean went and Lise did some research. And she tweeted me. Can you believe that Gene tweets? It's awesome. But I'm gonna play a video from his ministry this morning. That's kind of my punt, so to speak, for my message. But Karl Barth, you can write that name down, K-A-R-L-B-A-R-T-H, was a Swiss Reformed theologian who is often regarded as the greatest Protestant theologian of the 20th century. Now listen to this, because this is really, you need to grasp this. In the Church of Jesus Christ, there can be and should be no non-theologians. You know, this week on Wednesday, we're having this luncheon for pastors of Scott County. There's about 80 different churches throughout Scott County, and they're hoping for a majority of the pastors in Scott County will come to this meeting this week at New Day Church in town to hear about the vision of Revive Scott County. But I'm here to tell you this morning, you're just going to keep hearing more and more about this until October. And then in October, what we're going to say is, here's when we're going to have the event in New Prague, and we need you to come with us to go engage people on the street. And it's only as good as believers' willingness to rise up and accept the challenge. How many of you have ever done any sort of witnessing outside the four walls of the church? Raise your hand. You've ever talked about your faith. Okay, so the reality is, you really kind of have to know what you believe. That's what Karl Barth is saying. He said, look, you have to, it's not that you're going out there to debate people. You're out there proclaiming the greatness of your God, and you have to know what you believe. You have to be able to, the most powerful tool that we have to share our faith is our testimony.
Amen. Yes.
This is what God has done in my life. And how many of you know, like, imagine, if you will, those of you who have ever given birth, so that eliminates all the guys here. Amen. Imagine if you were describing the experience to your husband after the fact, and he said this to you. No, I don't think that's how it went. I don't think that's what you felt. I don't think that's what you thought. I don't think... You'd slap him, right? And for good reason. Well, that's the gist of what Christianity in the first century in the book of Acts was all about. These people, and by the way, it was 12 people who turned the world upside down. It started with 12. Think about that. 12 people. Why? Because they knew what they believed. Exodus chapter 3, verse 11. I don't have it for you on the screen, but you can look at it in your Bibles this morning. It says this. But Moses said to God, now this is Moses having a conversation with the Lord about going into the promised land. And Moses isn't too sure about it. How many of you, God's called you to do something and you're a little unsure about it? Amen. And so you call a prayer meeting, quote unquote, and in the prayer meeting, you ask the Lord, now wait a minute, Lord, hold on a second. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. Now, isn't it just funny how our faith, you know, is still like, okay, you're going to go with me. Are you like when your kids are little and you have to reassure them that you're going to come home or you're not going to leave them when you drop them off somewhere? So God said this, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Now, here again, Moses wants to negotiate. He wants to talk a little bit about the plan. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. See that? I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am sent me to you. That's an all-encompassing proclamation, isn't it? I am has sent me. Mark 10. Weber is a great pastor, and he said this: the first step toward God, the one true God, is to acknowledge that we are not that God. Don't you love that? The first step toward the one true God is to acknowledge that we are not that God. Now think about this. This belief sets us at odds with the cultural norms of our day. How many of you have ever been driving down the road and you're at a stoplight and you notice the bumper sticker on the car in front of you says this: coexist? How many of you ever seen that? That's the religion of our day. How many of you know that when you show up on the scene to talk with someone about the Lord and you say, "I am has sent me," that messes with the coexist bumper sticker? Right? Because you're not sent from Buddha. You're not sent from Joseph Smith. You're not sent from Muhammad. "I am has sent me." That puts us at direct odds with our culture. And the reason that we're talking about what we believe, the reason that we're looking at what the Bible has to say about our beliefs, is because I, as your pastor, want to ensure that you are equipped and that you know what you believe. Amen. Now think about this for a minute. I shared this last week. 80%+ of Americans identify as Christians. And only 24% of Americans think the Bible is the Word of God. Who loves math? Okay, how many is like, we have a problem with math? This week, I was at... You guys don't always know what my week looks like, and it looks different every week, but this week I was at North Central University for a pastor's gathering. And as you may or may not know, North Central University has a new president, Scott Hagen. And so the pastors, this is something new they were doing, they sent out a thing to all the pastors in Minnesota saying, "We want you to come down." They have a, I don't even know what it's called anymore, they change the name all the time, but in essence, it's a spiritual emphasis week this week at North Central. So they bring in guest speakers and guest worship leaders, and they invited pastors to just come down, attend chapel, intermingle and worship with the students, and then have a luncheon afterwards. And they were overwhelmed with the response. They ran out of room for seating for the pastors because so many pastors. Now, you need to know that at the exact same time, enrollment at North Central for ministry degrees has been steadily declining, meaning that there's less people who are feeling called to ministry and then responding by attending North Central. So there's a motivation there by our president, I'm sure, to get pastors on campus to intermingle with students and talk to them about the call of God to ministry. Because how many of you know God needs pastors and evangelists and prophets and teachers? Well, anyways, what we prayed through, because we heard, is that the North Central University wants to be on the cutting edge of equipping Pentecostal students to reach their world. But they're also mindful of the fact of the type of culture that we live in today. The coexist bumper sticker. Now, you don't have to write these down, but I think it's worth mentioning some of these isms. ISM. Materialism. Would you say materialism is prevalent in our culture today? Materialism is the belief that the universe constitutes all the God, small g, there is. In other words, it's just the physical makeup of the universe. That's it. Polytheism is the belief in many gods. In India, they believe in more gods than there is population. And India is huge. I think it's second to China, if not first. Pantheism is the belief that God is all and all is God. In other words, you know, this music stand is God. Whereas deism, which is what we're talking about this morning, is the belief that God is the creator. But, this, if you don't add Christian to it, deism is the belief that God is the creator but removed us from us and unapproachable. So we believe in Christian deism, the belief that God is the creator, but he is involved in our daily lives. So you may be here this morning wondering, why is believing in the one true God so important? Why is that so important? Well, number one, if you're taking notes, write this down. God, or I am, as we read in our text this morning, is the creator of the universe. Yeah. Amen? That's a fundamental belief that is so important. I heard a story one time about a guy who bought us, him and his wife were getting ready to go on this trip. And so he wanted to buy her a new camera. He wanted to buy a new camera for the trip. And so they went on this trip and he took lots of pictures, hundreds and hundreds of pictures. And when they got home, the wife was, you know, excitedly showing them to her friends, showing all these pictures. And the husband was in the kitchen and could overhear the conversation, and all he kept hearing from the people who were there was, wow, your husband must have a really nice camera. And he kept hearing it over and over, so much so that he was annoyed. And after they left, and he's like, what is it that people, all I noticed is that the camera was nice. Because he was the one who had taken the picture, and yet he was getting no credit. How many times do we watch a sunset, look at a storm, think about nature and beauty, and go, wow, it's awesome. And you hear these words, Mother Nature is amazing. No, she's not. God is amazing. And so what we see in our world today is people, all of us, if we're alive today, and do you know that what a miracle it is for you to be alive? Do you know the odds that were against you being born? It's like amazing. We get the advantage of seeing beauty in our creation, and yet so many people see it and they don't give honor to the Creator. The reason that I am is important is so that when you and I watch the sunset tonight, and if you're crazy enough to get up and watch the sun rise tomorrow morning, we can acknowledge that God is great.
Yes.
Some people make the argument that no one should claim that there is one true God. But as we're going to see, everything about theology is connected. Last week, we just talked about God's word being true. And if God's word is true, and we believe it is, it tells us the story of our Creator. But not only that, it tells us the story of Moses having the conversation with the Lord, where the Lord says, tell him I am sent you. Nehemiah said this in Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 6. He said, you alone are the Lord. You have made the heavens. The heaven of heavens with all of your hosts, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them, you give life to all of them, and the heavenly hosts bows down before you. When you understand that God is the creator of the universe, it's a very powerful thing. Very powerful. You look at what's happening in our culture today with young people and social media and how they struggle with their self-image, their self-worth, because they go on Instagram and they compare themselves to all of these beautiful models who only post photoshopped pictures of themselves. And they feel awful, and they look in the mirror and they see, you know, like me, I woke up with a big old zit on my forehead this morning, just out of nowhere. Like, where did this come from? Right? And I don't have a makeup person before church. So if that's you, no, I'm just kidding. You see, when you understand that you're created, and that you're created in God's image, and that you're fearfully and wonderfully created, that means that God didn't make a mistake when he created you.
Amen.
only 5'6" and a half and wish you were 6'2". That was a joke. You can laugh. It's okay. I was talking about myself. You have the confidence, not because of some article or book that you read, but because of what the Bible says.
Amen.
I am fearfully and wonderfully made, zits and all. I'll just keep moving. Secondly, if God I Am is the creator of the universe, God I Am is the moral judge. We talked last week that people who identify as Christians, who don't believe necessarily the Bible is the word of God, are unsure if God created the world and equally unsure if he is the moral judge of the universe. And yet, what does everybody do when some sort of serial killer rapist gets killed? They say, there's a special place in hell, right, for that person. Because God has put his law in our hearts. God has put justice in our hearts. So we see evil. We understand that is evil. We know that is evil. We identify it as evil so much so that even if we don't say we believe in God, believe in his word, believe that he created the universe, that there's a special place in hell for evil people. How does that work, by the way? That's a whole bunch of real, you know, acrobatic things. Why? Because we do believe that God is the moral judge. James chapter 4, verse 12 said this, God alone who gave the law is the judge. James 4, 12. He alone has the power to save or to destroy. So what right do you have to judge your neighbor? God alone is the judge. I shared with this last week, but I love it so much, and it's worth repeating. I may repeat it again next week. But when all of this stuff was happening with the hurricane in Texas, you know, all these people were rising up and talking about Joel Osteen, and Joel Osteen's not doing this, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And someone just posted a very simple meme that said, I went to prayer this morning, and God, ironically, didn't ask me what Joel Osteen was doing. You see, it's so much easier to just see everybody else's shortcomings. Look, I can't see my zit this morning. Unless I have a mirror, right? After church, when I go up and talk to you, it's going to be glaring at you. It's like a big red light. Isn't that how it is, though, with us? We see everybody else's flaws. It's so apparent, right? Because we're all, here's the reality, we're all broken.
Amen.
We're all messed up.
That's right.
None of us is perfect.
Amen.
We all have shortcomings, no pun intended.
That's right.
But it's easier if I, you know, it's like easy pickings to have an internationally well-known pastor. I mean, that's easy. And yet, nothing changes. James in chapter 4, verse 12 said, what right do you have to judge your neighbor? You see, the confidence that we have is when we look at the world and we see how messed up it is, and my wife likes saying this, our belief is such that there's coming a day when God is going to make everything right. He is going to execute justice. He is going to bring about perfect peace when he comes again. So why is it believing in the one true God important? Because we believe that what we see, and I don't know if you noticed this, but did you notice when you watch the news, it's like Groundhog Day? You woke up, you know what? North Korea fired a missile. You know what? Someone did a terrorist attack. You know what? There was a shooting. Did you ever, like, realize, like, you wake up and you're like, is this Groundhog Day? It's like everything, I mean, like, I just woke up, there's another hurricane. Right? Well, there's a reason. We live in a fallen, broken world. It's not going to get fixed until Jesus comes. So this pipe dream that's out there in the media, oh, we gotta fix this and that. No, it's not gonna get fixed until Jesus comes. That's why Jesus said that we advance the kingdom of God, which is within us.
Amen.
It's not in the world. That's why it's so important what we believe. It drives my wife nuts because we have totally different... I'll buy you dinner this week because of this story. Whatever you want, Steve. She and I have such different morning routines. Like, I need, like, I can't do anything until there's liquid gold running through my veins. Am I right, Scott?
Amen.
So don't talk, don't turn on TV, don't turn on the radio until I hear the sweet, sweet by and by of the bun. B-U-M-N. You know, percolating. My wife turns on news right away. And that's how she gets her day started. It's her comfort. She listens to the news. And what she'll tell you is, she likes to listen to it because they reaffirm what she thinks, right? So that's why she listens. I'm like, I've heard this. I heard this yesterday. It's the same news. I heard it yesterday. What's today? Saturday. I heard Thursday. I heard it Wednesday. I heard it Tuesday. I heard it Monday. But that's just how we approach the day differently. But here's the caveat. We both have the belief in the end, God wins.
Yeah. Yeah.
That God is going to bring about justice,
yes,
and a new heavens and a new earth. And so we both get there. We just get there different ways. That doesn't mean I don't like news or read the newspaper. I do. I like to read things that challenge me. But my point is that when we believe that God is the moral judge, it changes even how we consume the news. Amen? Are you here this morning?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
All right, finally, I'm wrapping up. Number three. God, or I am, will have the final say. Now, that may sound similar, but it's different than the last one. And before, we were specifically talking about the fact that God is the moral judge. God, I am, will have the final say. Revelation chapter 5, verses 13 through 14 says this, "And I heard every creature in heaven and earth, and under the earth, and in the sea, and all that is in them, saying, to him who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb, be blessing, and honor, and glory, and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshipped. We are on this crazy spinning planet for God's pleasure. Amen? We are on this crazy spinning planet for God's pleasure. The Bible says that from him, through him, and to him are all things. And that's why our beliefs matter. If you're here this morning, I want to just encourage you and challenge you with this reality. God is on the throne. He is in control. He has not left us. I don't know. Here's the thing. I just want to close by telling just this perspective. I believe that God works in the affairs of men. Amen?
Amen?
Now, having said that, I don't like to say this is always what I think God is doing. What do I mean by that? Well, some people like to say, you know, this hurricane is a sign of God's judgment. Da, 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 da. I don't go there. I don't always know what God is doing and why he's doing it. I think it's plausible, but I don't think that it's possible to say with some sort of definitive answer, this is what God is doing. But having said that, I do wonder sometimes. And I don't know how many of you heard this, but two things related to the North Korea thing. And just so you know, these are the things we're praying about on Wednesday night, so you should come out and be a part of it. So, not this last test that they did, but the last one before that, I don't know how many of you heard this, but there's some speculation that their launch site was damaged. Like it started to cave in. And I just had to wonder. Right? And then the reason there's been kind of a gap between that test and this last one is there's been a solar storm happening. And they didn't want to do it because with the solar storm happening, when they launch, they lose all the data that they're trying to collect. Now, is that God's hand? Could be. Amen?
Amen.
I feel like when we pray, that's the direction we can pray. Amen. Are you hearing this?
Absolutely.
You know, that happened in the Old Testament.
Right. Right.
God foiled the schemes of the enemy.
Yes.
As everybody else that you look at when you watch the news, whatever news you watch, is fretting and, you know, out of their mind, you and I have the confidence, don't we, that God is in control. Because of what we believe, and therefore we can rest easy at night, knowing that He watches over us.
That's right.
While we sleep. Yeah. That's why it's important what we believe.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank You this morning for Your word and for Your goodness in our lives. As we leave from this place, I pray that You would encourage us and remind us of Your sovereignty. That You rule and reign on high today. That despite what may be happening in our fallen and broken world, You are in control. You're on the throne